Welcome to part 5 in the series, where I teach you how to build perfect buttons in After Effects. In the last video, we created several button styles, and in this video, we'll turn one of them into a MOGRT. We'll set up the custom drop shadow, and I'll include controls for the gradient fill and ghost button styles. To build this, we'll start from the drop shadow composition we had built in part 4. First, we need to optimize this comp. There's two instances of this button shape layer, and it uses tons of expressions. By pre-comping the button shape instead of using duplicate shape layers, we can cut the amount of expressions in half and it'll render faster. Small steps like this add up to optimizing the performance of your MOGRT. Delete the shadow shape layer and pre-comp the button layer. Two expressions break. Remove the position expression and reset it to the center of the comp. The button size expression breaks because we need to relink the target layer to the text layer in our drop shadow comp. In the drop shadow comp, we'll collapse transformations to keep it sharp and see the layer bounds. Parent the button to the text layer, and pick whip its position expression to the text's anchor point. Duplicate the button layer to create two instances. Rename the duplicate to shadow layer, add a fill, and change the color to black. Turn off the position expression, unparent it, offset it, and put it behind the other layers. Go to the middle position keyframe, which is the press state. Snap the shadow layer to the center so they're overlapping, and it's hidden when pressed. Now we have the same button pressing animation as before, and both precomps still reposition and resize with our text. We have two states for our button. Text layer starts at state 1. The position presses down and connects to the shadow layer at state 2, and then it moves back to the state 1 position where it started at. By using keyframes, every time we move the shadow layer, we have to adjust those position keyframes in the middle for state 2. This is easy in After Effects, but when we export this as a MOGRT, we won't be able to access the keyframes in Premiere. So we'll have to rig these up to a controller, and we're going to use essential properties. Essential properties are super powerful. Figma has components, Adobe Flash and Adobe Animate have symbols, and After Effects has essential properties. We can create reusable graphic components which are editable from a central control panel, and which can be reused in multiple places throughout our project. To demonstrate how they work, I'll build a cursor with two states using essential properties. Create a null and name it Control. I'll turn it into a guide layer and make it cyan. Go to Effect, Expression Controls, Checkbox. For the main cursor, open up its opacity and pick whip the checkbox. Then write const check equals at the front. On a new line, write if parentheses check equals equals 0, curly brackets 100, else curly brackets 0. In plain English, this says, if the checkbox is off, keep opacity at 100. Otherwise, set opacity to 0. When I toggle the checkbox on, the cursor layer disappears. Select the opacity property and copy and paste it onto the second layer. Then change check equals equals 0 to check equals equals 1. And now we're toggling these layers back and forth. I'll turn off the opacity expression so we can see both layers and recenter these cursors so they're overlapping. After I turn the expression back on, it now looks like the cursor is switching. Now go to Composition, open in Essential Graphics. This is the Essential Graphics panel, or EGP. Drag and drop the checkbox to add it into the EGP. We can still control this checkbox from the panel, but it becomes really powerful when we add this comp to another timeline. I've placed the cursor comp into this other scene, and we can toggle this checkbox back and forth to flip between the two cursors. We can even add keyframes to animate between the two states. Any changes we make at this top level only affects this instance of the cursor comp, while the pre-comp inside it can be edited, and all of those changes will ripple upwards to our main scene. Okay, back to building the button. We could rig this button with checkboxes, just like we did the cursor, to toggle between the two states, but I want it to smoothly move and interpolate between these two positions. We can use linear for this. Create a new null object, rename it animation, and add a slider to it named animation as well. Keyframe the slider to go from 0 to 100 and back to 0. Parent the text and shadow layers to this null layer. Remove the text layer's position keyframes and alt-click it to add an expression instead. Write const driver equals, and then pick whip the animation slider. Then write const square bracket xy, and pick whip the shadow's position property, and add dot value. Then const p1 equals linear parentheses driver, comma 0, comma 100, comma 0, comma x. Const p2 equals linear driver 0, 100, 0, y. And at the bottom, square brackets p1, p2. Now anywhere we position the shadow layer will automatically drive state 2. By default, linear can remap ranges between 0 and 1. So we can actually remove the 0 and 100 from our linear expressions if we change the state 2 keyframe to a value of 1, and our expression will work exactly the same. Drop this comp onto the new composition button to add it to a new composition. We'll name that new comp MOGRT. Name the original comp button states. Open button states in Essential Graphics and add the animation slider to the EGP. In its parent MOGRT comp, those keyframes have become essential properties, and we can change their timing or easing totally independently. In the MOGRT comp, go to Composition, Responsive Design Time, Create Intro. Slide these markers so they surround the keyframes. Responsive Design Time is locking the timing between these markers. When we add the MOGRT comp to another scene, we can stretch the MOGRT layer to retime it, and the press animation always stays locked within the blue section. The blue section is protected from any speed changes, and won't get time stretched with the rest of the layer. This feature is extremely powerful, because it bakes into the MOGRT and will work in Premiere. At this point, we've finished all the prep work and have a solid After Effects template. In this final section, we'll build a control panel for the MOGRT so that we can export it to Premiere. Go back to the MOGRT comp, right-click it, and hit Open in Essential Graphics. Open up the button states comp and drag and drop the shadow layer's position into the EGP. Now we can control the shadow distance and position from this one control. Drag and drop the fill color into the EGP, so the editor can control the color of the drop shadow. Let's also add the drop shadow opacity to the EGP, so we can control the transparency. This doubles as an on-off control. We'll dive back into the button shape comp. Add the button padding and roundness controls to the EGP. Create a group called button controls, a subgroup for corners, and a subgroup named drop shadow. Clean up all of the control names and move them to their respective groups. Go back to the button states comp and add a fill effect to the button text layer, and rename it to text color. Then open up the source text and add that property. Create a group called text controls, and add this text color control and the button text property into that group. The text controls are important, so I'll put that group at the top. Back in button shape, search stroke width and add that to the EGP. When we test this slider in the control panel, the range is too large and it's difficult to use. This slider range needs to be clamped. Go back to the MOGRT comp and create a new null called MOGRT control. Add a new slider, name it button stroke width, and lock the effect controls panel. Let's collapse transformations on button states and then navigate back down into the button shape comp. Find stroke width and pick whip it to this new slider and add this one to the EGP. This slider control has an option to edit the range, and we can clamp the max stroke width down to something reasonable, like 100 or 50. Now we have a clamped slider. We can delete the other stroke width property from the panel and go back to button states. We could add the opacity for the button fill directly to the EGP, like we did for the shadow. But instead, let's add an on-off toggle for the fill, just like we did for the mouse cursor. Add a checkbox to the MOGRT control layer, named button fill on-off. A quick way to write the on-off expression is to pick whip the checkbox and write times 100. This turns the opacity on when the checkbox is on. Right-click the checkbox, hit Add to Essential Graphics, and then organize the button controls. Let's add colors. Create a color controls group. Go back to the button shape comp, search color, and directly drop the stroke color into the EGP. With a regular fill, we can do the same thing. However, to use a gradient fill, it's not that easy. We can't add the colors of a shape layer's gradient fill to the EGP, so we'll use a tint effect. Go to Effects, Color Correction, Tint, and add that to the button. This works great for the gradient, but when I turn up the stroke width, it's tinting our stroke as well. We need to separate our stroke and fill to two layers. We could use two shape layers, but that would be slow and bad for optimization. Instead, we'll use essential properties to create two new instances of the button shape comp. Precompose the button shape and rename it to button fill slash stroke. Make sure to have leave all attributes checked, otherwise it'll break your expressions. Duplicate it and rename the top one to stroke and the bottom one to fill. We can collapse transformations on both. Go inside the button shape comp and delete the tint effect that we had added. Open the gradient fill and the stroke contents. Open button shape in Essential Graphics and add the gradient fill opacity and stroke width opacity to the EGP. When we go back up to the button fill stroke comp, both layers now have essential properties, and we can control them independently from each other. Turn down the stroke on the fill layer, and turn down the gradient fill opacity on the stroke layer. Now we have the fill and stroke separated to two layers, even though they're built from the same button precomp. Essential properties are awesome. On the fill layer, add the tint effect. Because the gradient inside the button shape is black and white, tint works perfectly to remap it to two new colors. You can flip the stroke in front or back for whatever look you're going for. Open the MOGRT Essential Graphics panel again. Add the colors from the tint to the EGP, and rename to Fill Color 1 and Fill Color 2. Now we have control over our gradient colors in the MOGRT. For a solid color, an editor can just make both colors the same. Go back to the button states comp. If we toggle off the button fill checkbox, it's turning off both the stroke and the fill. Copy the opacity expression to the clipboard, and then alt-click the stopwatch to remove it. Go inside it and paste that expression onto the fill precomp. Now when we toggle off button fill, we can still see the stroke. Back in the button states comp, it's working correctly. However, when I unsolo this layer, the shadow layer is still showing the fill. When I toggle the source name in the timeline, we can see that the shadow layer is still using the button shape precomp. Select the shadow layer, then go up to the project panel. Holding Alt, drag the button fill slash stroke precomp over the shadow layer, and then let go to replace it. Now the shadow layer is using the same precomp, so the fill can be toggled off for both of them. And now our ghost button style is available. I'll go back to our main scene comp. Because we've used essential properties, we can see them all under our MOGRT layer. We can edit any of these essential properties, and the changes will only affect that instance of the MOGRT. We can even edit multiple button instances to be styled independently from each other. If we make a change to the MOGRT, that change will ripple upwards, while all the edited properties will be maintained. The last two controls we need to add are global controls, so an editor can resize and reposition the whole button MOGRT from the essential graphics panel. Parent the button states comp to the MOGRT control null, and open up its position and scale. Add these properties to the EGP, close up the other groups, and create a new group for the global controls at the top of all the groups. These global controls will give an editor quick access to moving the button around. Close all the groups so it's neatly organized. The button MOGRT looks good. Move the time indicator to the midpoint of the MOGRT, and hit set poster time to create a thumbnail image. Instead of untitled, we'll name it button MOGRT. Finally, we can export this button MOGRT for Premiere. Hit export at the bottom. Export to the local templates folder so it'll show up automatically in Premiere. In Premiere, open up the graphics workspace, or go to Window, Essential Graphics. Go to Browse and find the MOGRT. Drag and drop it to the sequence to import. Click Edit. We have the same exact controls that we had built in After Effects. And because we spent time naming and organizing everything, we have a clearly organized EGP hierarchy. We've chosen controls like checkboxes, sliders, linked XY controls, and color controls that are intuitive to use. We made sure to clamp the stroke width slider so it doesn't have ridiculous slider values. And responsive design time allows us to shrink or stretch the MOGRT without distorting the timing of the button press. Finally, we can have multiple instances of the MOGRT in Premiere, all with completely independent settings, timing, and text. Well, that was a whole lot. This just scratches the surface of what's possible with MOGRTs. I hope you enjoyed the series and learned something along the way. Leave a comment if something blew your mind. I'd love to know what you found most useful. I'll be back with more videos soon. See you later.